Welcome, everyone. I'm Alan Mattiso, the Associate Director of the Baker Institute, and we're very pleased to see so many people out here on a Monday night. The Baker Institute is devoted to promoting research and discussion of public policy issues on the Rice campus. And we have had a long-standing interest in religion and public policy, so we were very pleased to be invited to co-sponsor this event with the Center for the Study of Cultures. The texts and traditions of the great religions admit of numerous interpretations, sometimes in conflict, and that poses a problem for believers, but also poses a problem for those outside the faith. At the present time, there are unnumbered Americans who are trying to understand respectfully, Islam, a religion about which not so long ago they knew almost nothing. And in this effort, there have been two issues that have been particularly vexing and problematic. First, what is jihad? And second, and this is the topic of this lecture series, this is the third in a series of three. The third is the role of women and the status of women in Islam. There could hardly, I think, be a topic more current and important than this one. I think we owe a debt to the people who brought this lecture series here, especially to Professor Laura Shahabuddin, who you'll meet in a few minutes, and to the Center for the Study of Cultures, whose director, Werner Kelber, will say a few words. Werner, would you come up here, please?
Good evening. On behalf of the Center for the Study of Cultures at Rice University, I welcome you to this third and last lecture in the series, Women and Gender in Islamic Societies. The series is an undertaking, is a lecture series jointly undertaking by the Baker Institute and the Rice Center for the Study of Cultures. I remember many months ago now when I first approached the ambassador whether the Baker Institute might jointly sponsor the series, he responded instantaneously and enthusiastically. And I'm most grateful to you for having joined the Center for the Study of Cultures. During the academic year 2003-2004, the Center for the Study of Cultures has sponsored, co-sponsored, organized, administered, and in part initiated over 50 academic events. These events include individual lectures, a symposium, 5 major conferences, the last one took place here on the Rice campus this past weekend, and also a musical performance, a concert forthcoming by Shepherd School of Music performers and composers in the Rothko Chapel. The topics of all these events range widely, and they deal, for example, with the German Enlightenment philosopher Leibniz, or a lecture on Can Animals Think?, a lecture by the founding director of the Jewish Museum in Berlin, or a conference on the rise of modernity in China. Many topics dealing with African history, a good number of topics dealing with modern Western literary theory. The series Women and Gender in Islamic Societies is one of those 50 events. Of all these events sponsored by the Center, I attribute a special significance to this series, both for intrinsic and for extrinsic reasons. For intrinsic reasons, perhaps even more important than the second category, because Islam and Arabic civilization constitute a significant, a huge part of human history, which deserves to be studied and appreciated on its own terms and on its own merits. For extrinsic reasons, because Islam and Arabic civilizations have turned out to be relevant, sometimes tragically relevant, very often, I think, productively relevant for Western culture and in particular for US history. I sincerely hope that this series is but the beginning, not the end, but the beginning of a continuous and more sustained effort on the part of the university, of the Baker Institute, and certainly all I can do on the part of the Center for the Studies of Culture to think about this important subject matter more deeply and more thoroughly. It is my pleasure now to introduce to you my colleague, Professor Ilora Shihabuddin, who really was and is the driving force of this lecture series. And she, in turn, will introduce the speaker of this evening. Ilora, please.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming. It's a great turnout, and I'm sure it'll be a great lecture. It is my great honor and privilege to be able to introduce to you our speaker this evening. Before I do that, however, I'd like to say a few words about the lecture series itself and what prompted us here to organize it. Much attention has been focused on Muslims and Islamic societies in the last few years, but this attention has not always enhanced understanding. Representations of Islam in the Western media and even academic scholarship continue to be shaped both by misleading assumptions and outdated categories of analysis, when what we all desperately need is an informed perspective on Islamic history and contemporary Islamic societies. This lack of understanding is particularly glaring in issues related to women or gender in Islam. We are all familiar with the image of the veiled, submissive, passive Muslim woman. This image leaves us with the impression that there is such a thing as one Islamic culture and society, that there is little to distinguish between the 1.2 billion Muslims in the world, that Islam is inherently oppressive to women, and that it has remained largely unchanged over the last 1400 years. This is all, of course, posited in implicit contrast to a robust, dynamic, modern Western culture. By focusing on symbols like the veil, such stereotypes take away from the multiple meanings attached to the veil itself, and indeed from the very real problems that women, Muslim and non-Muslim, throughout the world face today. Such images do not help us understand the diverse histories, cultures, and practices of Muslims from North America to Southeast Asia. Most importantly, for the purpose of this series, such images ignore the different emancipatory movements that have emerged within the Muslim community, many of them initiated and led by Muslim women themselves. The three speakers we invited to participate in this series are truly remarkable Muslim women of different national and academic backgrounds. What they share is a commitment to activism on behalf of women. It is our hope that through their own personal examples and their formal presentations, they will leave you with a new critical understanding on the subject of women and gender in Islamic societies. Our speaker this evening is Professor Azizah Al-Hibri. She is currently Professor of Law at the University of Richmond, and in the past has held positions at Washington University, St. Louis, and at our neighboring school, Texas A&M. She holds a PhD in philosophy as well as a JD from the University of Pennsylvania and a BA in philosophy from the American University of Beirut. A shift in career happened at some point. Her research interests range from comparative legal theory to law and technology to feminist theory and corporate finance, and she has published on as vast a range of subjects. Her current book project is on the Islamic marriage contract in American courts. In 1993, she founded an organization of Muslim women lawyers for human rights called Karama, which translates as dignity. The organization is committed, I quote, to research, education, and advocacy work in matters pertaining to Muslim women and human rights in Islam. I first encountered Professor Al-Hibri's work as an undergraduate, and I feel compelled to share with you a passage that has stayed with me all these years, with very important political, academic, and personal implications. It is from her introduction to a very important volume called, very simply, Women and Islam, published in 1982. I say very simply because if you're familiar with academic texts, it's usually a simple title than a complicated subtitle, and hers is just Women and Islam. The quote, "Feminist Muslims should not be intimidated by the Muslim patriarchal authority. Instead, they should be guided by the fact that there is no clergy in Islam, each person being responsible directly to God for her own beliefs. Furthermore, if patriarchy itself was able to justify within its ideological bounds the existence of five different schools of thought, then feminists can surely justify the addition of at least one more." End of quote. In the two decades since then, Professor Al-Hibri has continued her work in reinterpreting the Quran and Islamic laws from what she calls a womanist perspective. It is on this topic that she will speak to us tonight. I'm sure we're all very eager to hear her, so I'll stop right here. Please join me in welcoming to Rice University Professor Azizah Al-Hibri.
Thank you, all of you, for such nice introductions that set the stage for my discussion, but I want to thank you specifically for bringing a homesick Aggie back home to Texas. I just wish I had more time to play around and remember my time around here. What I would like to talk to you about, since we have a limited time, in discussing the role of women, is to say the following. You cannot understand the role of women or the rights of women in Islam unless you understand the basic Islamic worldview. That is, there isn't one piece that you could take out and say, this is what I'm going to study, and be totally unaware of what's happening elsewhere. And so I'm going to start very quickly with a worldview, which is based, all my work, by the way, is based on traditional sources. Most of all, it's based on the Quran, but it takes into account not only the hadith, but the works of traditionalists, medievalists, who turn out to be more feminist than the patriarchal thinkers of today. First of all, to understand Islam, we have to understand the basic concept, the most important concept in Islam. And the most important concept is that of tawhid. Tawhid meaning a belief in a single God, no more, no less. From that fact flows a lot of conclusions and a lot of consequences. I point this at the outset because in a minute you will hear how it becomes very important to defining the role of women in Islam. One of the important, or the most important value in Islam, when you ask a Muslim, what is Islam about morally? What they will tell you is that the most important value or concept is that of justice. And that's the other thing I want to bring to your attention. This word alone, justice, can be misunderstood. I've been in discussions with women who are not Muslims from the Western Hemisphere, not necessarily just the U.S. And the understanding when you say justice is that we're talking about retributive justice, punitive justice, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. That's not the concept of justice that the Quran talks about. It's rather a concept of justice which is tempered with love and mercy and forgiveness. I will not go too much into that concept unless the occasion arises, but I would like to say that this concept of justice is reflected in the world as a whole, in the universe, in society, in polity, in the individual, in our relationship with each other. So for example, in terms of the universe, the notion of balance is right there in the Quran when it says that God has created the world in a certain balance, and the firmament has he raised high, and he has set up the balance of justice, in order that you may not transgress due balance. Not only is the universe in balance, but you may not transgress due balance. I'm emphasizing this because the way you lead your life is part of this whole scheme of justice. And therefore, talking about the relationship of male and female is not just something that we're doing in a Western society interested in feminism. We're talking about a basic notion of justice in Islam. And it is very important to keep society in balance. The earth we have spread out and set there upon mountains. Other places it says, the sun cannot overtake the moon, nor the night will overtake the day. Everything is in its own constellation. All of this is a notion of a balance, a universal balance. In society, the notion of balance is explained in a variety of ways, including justice to the vulnerable people in society, the orphans, the women, the enslaved at that time. And we bring about balance in a variety of ways, including tithing, including sadaqah, which is alms. And it tells you in the Quran, you know, most of us, we have in nature, is discussed, described as al-anfus al-shuh, as stingy souls. And so we have to fight against the stingy soul to tithe and to do zakat. And it says to people, give God alone as a sadaqah. So whatever you give to the poor is a loan to God, and God will return it tenfold. In this state, the notion of justice is expressed in a variety of ways, in a limited number of principles that I will talk about. In this state, if you remember, we have the model of the city-state of Medina, which is the very first state that was established among Muslims. And in that state, the Muslims came and chose a head of state, somebody to govern them in Medina. How did they choose that head of state? Well, the question already shows that it was a choice. The prophet did not walk in and say, I am the prophet around here, and you know what, I have a direct relationship with God, so I should be running the affairs of the city. Not at all. The people came and gave what is called bay'ah, their vote of confidence to the prophet. In particular, if you remember, in the Quran it says, and the women came and gave the prophet their bay'ah. Bay'at al-Nisa, which is very famous in the Quran and in the literature. And what did the prophet say? Well, he didn't tell the women, get out of here. Hey, are you crazy? You're women. What are you doing here voting for me? I don't need your vote. I have all the men on my side. He didn't do that. He sat and chatted with the women, basically to ensure that the vote is on basic principles, that there are certain criteria on which the relationship of the person who is being voted for and those who are voting work together. If that is the case, by the way, and women have already given their bay'ah in the Quran to the Prophet, then how is it that today, in some Muslim countries, in particular Kuwait, it is questionable, actually forbidden at this point, not permitted, that women would vote? And we are told that this is an Islamic issue. It is not an Islamic issue. The Quran itself says that women voted. Okay? You couldn't be more clear than that. So the issue is really cultural. It's not Islamic. And these issues, these questions must be faced head on. People who claim that they are denying Muslim women their rights on the basis of religion need people who know religion to face them down and say, explain yourself. If the Quran says that the women came and gave the bayah to the Prophet, who are you to say that women may not have the vote? Now, let's go back to the state that we were talking about. And in this state, therefore, one thing that is established through the Quran is that whoever governs must govern with the consent of the people. Consent becomes a very important issue in Islam. That is one of the hallmarks of an acceptable state. And the other one is also revealed in the verse, which orders, God orders the Prophet to ensure that he is engaging in shura. It says to the Prophet, consult with those people around you. It is better for their heart. They will feel better. And in many occasions we know the Prophet took the advice and abandoned his. He did not do shura in matters of revelation, but in everything else he did. So, in other words, when you are governing a society, the people governing must first be selected by the people through the consent of the people, and secondly, they must be in constant touch with the people, asking for their advice and consultation. This is, by the way, part of what we call democratic system. There's a lot more to a democratic Western system than this, balance of powers, constitutional rule, etc., all of which I can address in another lecture, and I have already published about it, to show that Islam is quite consistent with this mode of governance. Moving from there to the more important, in terms of our topic today, realm, the realm of the family, and the realm of gender relationships, we ask, how does the Quran view women? How does the Quran view marital relationships and the family and the rights of women within and without the family? Now, first of all, I need to share with you a little story which will also enlighten my discussion about the state, but furthermore will enlighten my discussion about women. This story comes from the Quran. Many of you are familiar with part of the story in the Bible. So let me start with that part. When God created Adam from clay and taught Adam the names. I think you all remember that. It's also in the Quran. But then the Quran goes on to say, and then God summoned the angels and Iblis, being the devil, Iblis is the devil, and ordered them to bow to Adam. Right? For those who read the Quran. And what happened? Well, the angels bowed to Adam because they're angels. They do the right thing every time, but not Iblis. Iblis said, I'm not going to bow to Adam. I won't. Okay. Before we go further with the story, let's ask ourselves what happened when Iblis said, I will not bow to Adam. He obviously disobeyed a direct order from God. Okay? That means he made his own will superior to God's will. But God's will is supreme. That's what tawheed is, the belief in a single God. So anybody who makes any will equal or superior to that of God is associating other partners with God. And that is a crime that God says he will not forgive. He may forgive any other thing, but not shirk, associating God's other gods with God. But that is exactly what Iblis did. Now, the God of Islam is the God of Christianity and the God of Judaism. At least that's what I believe, even if some others doubt that. And what this means is that it's a God who's all-knowing, all-powerful, and all-good. For a God who's all-knowing, now we wonder why in this recounting of the story in the Quran, God goes on and asks Iblis, what prevented you from obeying me? And then there's a dialogue between God and Iblis. And the interpretation is, I think the logical interpretation is that the dialogue is for us to learn from it, not for God to find out about Iblis, because God created Iblis. All right. But look at the question, what prevented you from obeying me? And Iblis answers, hey, it's obvious. How could I possibly bow to Adam? How could I possibly bow to Adam? You created me from fire, and you created him from clay. I'm better than he is. And he was cursed as a result, till judgment day. I am better than he is. This story was picked up by Imam Ghazali, among others. Imam Ghazali is a famous jurist of medieval times. And he wrote about it, just a couple of lines, in his Ihya Ulum al-Din, a very famous treatise. And in it he said, you know, some of you might think, I'm paraphrasing what he said, some of you might think that this is a story about something that happened a while back, in early history. Wrong. This story is not just about that, it's also about us today. And he says, what this means is that anyone who uses Iblisi logic is committing the Iblisi mistake and shirk. And what is Iblisi logic? It's vanity, it's arrogance. I'm better than he is. And he says that means, and I'm quoting now Al-Ghazali from medieval times, if you are a rich person and you think you're better than a poor person, you've committed Iblisi logic. If you are white and you think you're better than a black or a red person, you've committed Iblisi logic. And if you are a free person and you think you're better than a slave, you've committed Iblisi logic. That's the falsehood of arrogance and of vanity. Well, I could add to Al-Ghazali, and if you think you're a man and that makes you better than a woman, you've committed a piece of it. Well, where am I coming with this from? Let's look at prophetic logic. Or divine logic, as opposed to Iblisi logic. Now we know arrogance and vanity. And by the way, not only Islam thinks that, Christianity does too. And why shouldn't they if it is the same God, right? Now let's look at prophetic logic. And by the way, there's an article out there I can tell you about, which also argues that the logic I'm going to share with you now is the logic of Jesus and Moses and Abraham and not only Muhammad, okay? Because it's the logic of the prophets. Well, this time I'm going to posit the argument from a Qur'anic point of view. What does the Qur'an tell us about the rich and the poor and the black and the white and all these people?
They're not equal.
Well, let me start at the beginning.
Yes.
All right? The Qur'an says very clearly that I have created you of a single soul. God created all of us of a single nafs, or soul, or spirit. Now, there is a principle, juristic principle of understanding the Quran. If a thought is repeated in many verses, in different ways, then it is a central thought in the Quran. If it happens only once, it's important, but it is not as central. Now, here's the central one. We've created you all of a single nafs. Go and see how many times this is repeated in the Quran. Now, I'm going to focus on one rendition, simply because I cannot go through all of them here. One version says, I have created you all of a single nafs, and of that nafs I created its mate. This is the gender differentiation. There is no Adam's rib in the Quran. Male and female are created of the same nafs or soul. And then it is based on this reason, based on this statement and other statements like it in the Quran, the spiritual rights of Muslim women have never been differentiated from those of men. They have the same rights and obligations. Okay? The verse goes on to say, we've created you from a single nafs and made of it its mate. And of those we created you, we made you into nations and tribes. So ethnicity comes. You first have the nafs, then the gender differentiation, then ethnicity and tribes and different colors and tongues in another verse. All of this, suddenly we had a nafs and now we have everybody. And you ask yourself, God, why are you doing this to us? Because now we have to ask, is male better than female? Is black better than white? Is, all these questions. Why complicate our lives? Why didn't you, God, create us as one nafs? And stop there. Well, the Qur'an answers. It says that God created us from a single nafs, made us into male and female and nations and tribes, so that we get to know each other, لتعارفوا, to enjoy each other's company, to communicate. Diversity is the spice of life. You don't want to be talking to somebody who's exactly like you every day. You know, that could drive some people nuts. Diversity is the spice of life. Okay? So we weren't created different so that we can find a hierarchy and then try to plug ourselves either at the top or whatever, you know, everybody wants to be at the top and fight over it. This is not why we were created to be diverse, but to have relationships with each other, to get to know each other. Well, then the question arises, if I cannot order myself on the basis of gender or ethnicity or even riches, or how am I going to know where I am in the hierarchy? What do I know about that? And the verse goes on to say, the closest to God in the sight of God are those who are most pious. So it is, or righteous. It is your righteousness that brings you close to God, not the color of your skin or your gender or whatever. God created all those, but it is your righteousness that brings you closest. And who can be most righteous? Any one of you. This is really totally in your hand. Nobody can take that away from you. You give it to yourself. So in that sense, we're equal. Even though not everybody will end up righteous, we're equal initially to decide who we are going to be. And that turns out to be the prophetic logic, as opposed to the satanic logic. The logic of righteousness, the logic of serving the other instead of thinking you're better than the other, is the satanic logic which believes and sticks to hierarchies. All right, having talked about that, let's now turn to the issue of gender specifically. What do we know about women in the Quran? Well, that's a big issue, big question, but let's go to one specific ayah. It says, again, I've created you from a single nafs. And I create of that nafs its mate so that they will find tranquility with each other. So the model of gender relationships in the Quran is not one of a power struggle or even a power balance. Because when you're thinking power, you're not thinking prophetic logic. It is more one of tranquility. And in another verse, it says, God created you all from the same nafs and made from that nafs its mate and put between you tranquility, affection, and mercy. That's the relationship that the Quran speaks about. Okay? Where's that in real life? What's happening in Muslim countries? You know, we'll talk about that if you want to. But I think right now we really need to understand what the Quran says about these things. The Quran further states that the relationship between husband and wife cannot even begin without having basic democratic principles satisfied in the family unit. Now, I'm using modern terms to describe ancient ideas. What does the Quran say? What do the jurists say? What does Islamic jurisprudence say for years now? There is no marriage contract in Islam that is valid unless both parties have consented to it. It's a very simple fact. There is one exception that have been dropped in modern days that the Malikis argued that a young virgin daughter could be forced in marriage by her father alone because he knows her better interest. And now even Morocco, which used to adopt the Malikis, continues to adopt the Maliki school, has done away with that provision because it is not suitable for today's society. That is because the fundamental basis of any contract in Islam, let alone a marriage contract, is consent. There is no way you can have a contract without full disclosure so that you know what you're consenting to, and then the consent. If there is fraud in the marriage, you annul the marriage. You void the marriage. We can look at what's happening in Muslim countries in light of this and see that the practice is quite different from reality. The Prophet said that contracts, that Muslims must honor their contracts. Ufu bil wa'ud. And the Quran, by the way, said the same thing. Both the Quran and the Prophet. Muslims must honor their contracts. But the Prophet said very specifically, adding, and the contract most worthy of being fulfilled is that of the marriage contract. Why is that very important for the Muslim woman? Because in Islam, the marriage contract is basically a definition of the particular relationship of that family. When a woman says yes to a husband or a potential husband, she's saying yes based on what he told her about himself and what kind of a life he wants to lead with her. And that is why it is totally acceptable among the large majority of Muslim jurists that a Muslim woman could negotiate her contract and put in it the appropriate conditions for her that would define properly the relationship. And that is why the Prophet said, "Ufu bil'uqud," and the Quran said so. Fulfill your promises, and then the Prophet said, and the most serious of those is the marriage contract, because of the gravity of marriage. And what this meant is that if a woman decided to put the following condition in her marriage contract, that if she marries, her husband will not move away from his country and take her with him. She doesn't want to become an immigrant. She has the right to put that condition in, and he has to live up to it, because that's the kind of marriage they have contracted. She could also contract that she wants to continue her higher education after marriage. She wants to defer having children for a number of years. All of these things are things that are proper conditions in most jurisdictions, not every jurisdiction, that's more detailed than this lecture needs. These are conditions that are appropriate, and Muslim women throughout the ages, including the granddaughter of the Prophet, included in their marriage contract. I want to mention something to you. For the Muslims amongst you. But by the way, I'm very glad when you started talking, you mentioned that a while back we did not know anything about Islam, and now we need to know. Well, you know, the general feeling a few years ago was we know everything about Islam. We don't need to know anymore. And especially among Muslims. And when I started teaching Islamic jurisprudence in my class, the problem were the Muslim students who walked in and said, "I know everything, I'm going to get an A in this course." So, you know, I ask everybody, you know, let's all start from zero, because not everybody really is on the same page, and maybe there is no such page that you are on. Okay. Many Muslims, when you ask them, and I used to be one of them until I researched the topic, what is the marriage contract in Islam? They will tell you, oh, it's a civil contract. How many of you think that among the Muslims? Raise your hands. It's a civil contract. No one will admit to it now. Okay, some of you. And it is, right? I mean, and it is. You sit down and you write a contract. There's a sheikh who will witness it, and your dad or somebody, and you're done. Okay. You don't walk down the aisle and there's no music and no flowers and nothing. But when I was writing my book, somebody at the University of Chicago who is doing a project with me said, "Azizah, you know, is it really true Because, you know, in Christianity and Judaism, marriage is covenantal. At least some schools of thought in these religions say that marriage is covenantal. In Islam, it isn't at all. I said, no. And you're not going to push me to say yes just so that the three of us will fit under the same formula, right? But then I went home and I thought, you know, why don't I think about it a little bit more? And here's what I discovered, and I'm going to share this with you. As it turns out, if you look at the jurisprudence of Islam, and again, I argue this jurisprudence is a seamless web. You can't learn one piece without learning the other. As it turns out in Islam, every contract, marriage or otherwise, is covenantal. Every contract is made before God. And you will be asked about it by God in the afterlife if you shortchange the person with whom you've made the contract or did something wrong. And of course, the most worthy of those and the most important is the marriage contract, so that puts quite a burden now on us. It is civil in the sense that contracts are civil, but it is covenantal. On this earth, it's civil. You go to court to dissolve the marriage, but in the other life, there is a question between you and God whether you've been fair to your partner or not. Okay, I just wanted to share that with you because that seemed to be something new. Let's talk about the women's rights in Islam and in the family. You know, the Muslim woman is not supposed to change her name when she gets married. She keeps her maiden name. I kept my maiden name. Immigration services changed it. I went back, you know, because they said, I came here ages ago, right? First of all, they couldn't understand that I was not applying to change my citizenship right away. They said, if you're here and you're married to an American, you must become an American. I said, okay. And then you must change your name before the 60s, right? Now things are different. But in Islam, the woman is not supposed to change her name. Why? Because the women in Islam have always had a legal and actual entity, personal entity, which is independent. Let me talk about that. I think what I'm trying here to introduce to you is the notion of dhimma. And the best way I know of talking about dhimma is to talk about conscience first. Because everybody knows what a conscience is, right? You all know it. Don't show me where it is. Oh yeah, you do this, you do that. We don't know where it is, but we know it's there, right? It is the situs of really your moral concerns, obligations. The dhimma is really the situs of legal obligations of any human being that the Muslim jurisprudence has attributed. And just like the man has a dhimma, so does the woman have a dhimma. And she is fully entitled to enter into a contract, dissolve a contract, do business, do whatever she wants, regardless of what you hear from other Muslim countries these days. She has a full dhimma. One proof of that is that the Muslim woman has financial dhimma. What this means is that the money of the woman cannot be touched, either by her father or husband or her son or anybody else. It is totally hers, and she has full control over it. If a Muslim woman, and I'm going to tell you something that might surprise some of you. If a Muslim woman marries a man and he is not doing very well, well, first of all, he's supposed to support her unless she waives that. Otherwise, she is entitled to support because after all, she's going to have children, she's going to raise them, etc. So she's entitled to support even if she's rich and he's not. If she has more money than he does, he cannot come to her and say, I need your money. Let's be very clear, the Qur'an engages in affirmative action on behalf of women. There is no equality in the Qur'an. Women are given better rights than men. And that might surprise you, but that is the truth. Okay? And part of the affirmative action is, God knows what God created. A patriarchal society most of the time. And so if women start spending their money when they're young, trying to establish themselves with their husbands, and then something goes wrong and she no longer has her husband and she doesn't have her money, she's in big trouble. So women are not required to spend to support their husbands or give them any money.
but they are entitled to give the money to their husbands as gift, loan, or charity. But it's not adhered to. Now, in modern law, some of the Muslim countries are trying to change that around. That's a sign of modernization and, I guess, equality. That's an equality I can live without. Now, the Qur'an is very clear on the question of education. The Qur'an asks rhetorically, are those who know equal to those who don't? And it speaks quite repeatedly about the importance of knowledge. The Prophet himself, in a hadith that known to have argued about or dissented about, says that seeking knowledge is the duty of every Muslim, male or female. Now, I want to ask you, if everybody knows this, how is it that there was this huge argument a few years ago as to whether Muslim women can have an education or not? And in some countries, it was made more difficult. Something is going wrong here, obviously. People are not living up to the principles of their religion. What else is new? And it doesn't happen to Islam alone, okay? Now, let's talk about some other stuff. I've already talked about the marriage contract. I want to ask now, why do Muslims marry? In Islam, we have the following attitude. First of all, we take very seriously premarital and postmarital relationships. That is, you want to have sex, get married. That's the short answer, okay? And once you get married, do whatever you want, nobody's going to ask you. You know, have fun. And in fact, literally have fun, because for example, if the husband decides, hey, you know, I'm going to use some form of contraception, he can. But he has to get the consent of his wife. After all, this is a democracy. And the question among the jurists was not whether he should ask for consent or not. It was rather, how often should he ask? Every time? Or can he get a blanket waiver? And many jurists argue that because, you know, some of these methods for contraception reduce the sexual enjoyment of the woman, he has to compensate her monetarily each time. All of this goes to show that Islam is not shy about sexual enjoyment, so long as it is within the man. Because we're very concerned about the future of the children. Children need to have parents that will bring them up and guide them. And the child has in Islam rights against the parents, just like the parents have rights against the child. All right? Then, why do people marry? Well, partly because you can't have sexuality expressed otherwise, but that's not the only reason, because the Quran says very clearly what the primary reason is. What is the primary reason for marriage? God created us of a single soul and made of it its mate and put tranquility between them. And then elsewhere it says, and put tranquility, mercy, and affection between them. That's the whole idea of marriage. It is companionship. People don't marry because they're in need. They marry because they need friends. And your husband is supposed to be your best friend, because God put tranquility and affection and mercy between you. That's what marriage is about. And jurists said, okay. And now I'm really still stuck in the medieval period. I'm not giving you anything modern. Jurists said, okay. So the marriage contract is about that. So it is a companionship contract. So it isn't a service contract. So if you're getting married because you want somebody to cook and clean house and so on, you're wrong. Just go hire one. A woman in traditional Islam has no duty to do housework, because the marriage contract is not a service contract. And in fact, if the husband decides to live in a house at the outskirts of the city where there aren't many people around and he's traveling all the time, he has the obligation to get her a female companion to keep her company. If a husband comes home and says, "The woman, where's my dinner? You've been sitting home all day and I'm hungry and where's the food?" The Muslim woman should say, "Go get some." According to jurists, the Muslim man must either cook for his wife or get prepared food for her, because it's not part of her obligation to do service. Okay? Now, a lot of people regret inviting me after this. And yet, in many Muslim countries, when you look at the laws, you'll find that part of the obligation of the wife is to supervise the household. Well, most women supervise by doing it themselves, right?
Right.
But that is not Islamic. And when you're asked about it, they'll tell you it's cultural. Well, why do you let culture into Islam? Let's address that, and then I'll go back to the rest of the arguments or the times I want to tell you about Islam. Why do we let culture enter into Islamic law? Well, remember the verse I told you about at the beginning, about how God created us into male and female and nations and tribes? Jurists took this to mean that we must celebrate diversity, and that if Islam is spreading, then we should straitjacket everybody in the Arabic mold, for example, because Islam started in Arabia. But that the Islamic civilization will let a million flowers bloom. And you will have a Mughal civilization, you will have a Persian civilization, you will have Turkic civilization, all sorts of things. And they all express, as well as Islam, the culture of the people. And you can bring that culture with one proviso: it cannot violate an Islamic tenet. So you cannot bring from your culture idol worship. That's not going to work. But you can bring other things. And here we have a lot of jurists saying, oh, we brought in the obligation that the woman has to do housework because this is in our culture. Well, one could argue that this violates a very important tenet in Islam about gender relationships. But over the ages, that argument has not been made. I'll give you another fact about how Islam views women. There is a verse in the Quran about mothers, about pregnancy, and how tough it is to be pregnant. You know, you don't get a halo around your head when you're pregnant. You get a lot of pain. And the Quran speaks about that, that it is burden over burden when the woman is pregnant. And then she delivers. Because of that, jurists have argued that once the woman delivers, she does not have the obligation to nurse, unless nursing is a last resort for her child's health. That might surprise you again. It is cultural that women nurse. Remember, the Prophet was not nursed by his mother. He was sent in wet nurse. Mm-hmm. And that was acceptable in those days. The woman could, as moral obligation, decide to nurse her child, but no court and no husband could force the mother to nurse if she does not want to. This is one of her rights. There are a lot of things we do not know about. And one of the things we do not know about is the glorious number of Muslim women who've played an important role in the history of Islam. When we talk about women, you immediately remember Khadija and Aisha and others. But there are others you don't know about. But for those of you who are not familiar with Khadija, let me talk about her a little bit. She was a businesswoman, a very successful businesswoman, who hired the Prophet to work for her before he was a prophet. And he accepted. He didn't say, "I'm not going to work for a woman." Right? As we hear some men. You know, some men want to emulate the Prophet. Emulate him in his relationships to women. So he worked for her, and he was so honest and so admirable that she proposed to him in marriage. Now, if any of us tries to do that these days, she'd be viewed as a very forward woman. And yet Khadija could. There was no problem with that. Well, she was a very modern woman in our sense of modern. She was 20 years older than the Prophet. And she asked him, what do you think? He went, he consulted with his family, his tribe, her tribe. They decided that was a good situation. They married, and they were very much in love until she passed away. How could have Khadija done her business? By the way, she was the first Muslim, and she encouraged the Prophet when he was hearing the revelation. She was encouraging him. She said, "You're not hallucinating. This is a revelation from God. You know, be steadfast." How could Khadija have conducted her business if she was living with us today in some Muslim country, where they tell her that she cannot travel freely without she has to have the consent of her husband, etc., etc., and that she cannot be financially independent? How could she have possibly done what she's done? Aisha, who the Prophet married after the death of Khadija, contributed a huge amount of reports about the Prophet, which is really very substantial for our understanding of jurisprudence. More than half came from Aisha. And yet, you know, today very few Muslim women are studying Islam in school to be Muslim jurists. Even though the Prophet was surrounded with women, there were women companions, and even then, the society were obviously patriarchal, the women went to the Prophet one day and they said, look, we'll keep coming to listen to you along with everybody else, but we also need our own day, because the men, I guess, are talking too much. And the Prophet said, okay, and he gave them their day. He didn't say, you know, I don't have time to waste with you women. I have a religion to spread. You know, leave me alone. He went and had a day with the women on a regular basis. Even the Qur'an, when it's, you know, after the women talked to the Prophet, the revelation started distinguishing genders so that it says the women believers and the men believers. The righteous women and the righteous men. It started making clear that the universal language used early on is meant to include both male and female, and there is no distinction in these responsibilities. Well, I remember the story of Arwa, the queen of Yemen, when I was reading about her. She was such a good queen, a salihiyya. She ran the country so well. She made it better. Organized everything. And finally the men in her country said, because, you know, there's a question, should a woman lead us? You know, I mean, they're worried about that. They concluded that she must be a man in a woman's body. Okay. I think I need to wrap up. I don't know what the time is. I forgot to look at when I started. But I want to mention a couple of things. I want to go back to just talk about family relations one more time and say that in the Muslim family, the Quran says that people should live together, husband and wife should live together in kindness or leave each other in kindness. Imsakum bima'ruf wa tasrihum bi'ihsan. When I listen to the phone calls that come across my desk, come to me, I do not see that principle anywhere in today's marital relationships. Not only some of them do not want to live in kindness, some of them live in violence, which the Quran clearly does not permit. Because the statement is clear, imsakun bima'ruf. How could you be keeping somebody in kindness if you're being violent to them? Or tasrihan bi'ihsan, leaving them kindly. When they leave them, they don't want to leave them kindly. They want to hurt them. They want to hurt, you know, break their heart. I mean, that's not just Muslims. That's everybody. But it is, I guess, not everybody, but the mean people. That's in the Quran, that when you leave in kindness. And it says further that if you, even if you've given her a ton of gold, don't take a penny out of it. If you've given her gifts, a ton of gold, don't touch it back. And yet, many of the cases we have are cases where men do not want to pay the mahar or the marriage gift to their wives. So whether in the US or in the Muslim countries, we had a breakdown of basic Islamic principles. I started with the notion of justice, and I came down all the way through from the universe to the family. And as you see, justice in the family is expressed in democratic relationships and in kindness and in mercy and in tranquility. And when that balance is not there, then the balance of justice is no longer there. And something goes wrong with society. So something is very wrong in many places. And I think that it is our duty. I know it's our duty. Those of us who have the ability to speak about these things and do something about them, that we should do so. I hope you will help. Thank you very much.
Professor Al-Hibri will be answering some of your questions. Please keep your questions short, precise, no long speeches, just questions.
Yes, ma'am. Oh, sorry.
Yes, ma'am.
In the countries where you feel something has gone wrong, do you think it's because, two-part, it's a combination of church and state, and the government has been captured by extremely conservative church people?
First of all, let us be clear, there is no church in Islam. Just a couple of words so that you understand what I mean. There is no hierarchy in Islam. I just finished talking about the problems with hierarchy from an Islamic point of view. And so a Muslim directly talks to God, directly prays to God. We don't need an intermediary. But because each one of us, God gave us our reason, and God gave us the revelation. But it's okay that if you think somebody is who has spent their whole life studying a religion, and they have, you know, good ideas, that you might want to follow these ideas if you're convinced. That is, you don't follow blindly, you follow only if you're convinced. But that doesn't make for a church. Everyone is entitled to engage in interpretation or ijtihad. Everyone is entitled to that. But there are qualifications. Everybody in this room can be a philosopher, but you have to meet certain qualifications. What are they in the case of ijtihad? You have to have the knowledge. You must have read the basic documents, starting with the Quran and Hadith and others. And then when you interpret with righteousness. That is, you don't tell yourself, okay, now I'm required to come up with the following conclusion. Let's figure out how we come up with it. Okay? That doesn't work. So given that fact, then ijtihad is available to everybody. I do not think that using words that project the American system and concepts on the Muslim world would help us understand very much what's going on. Let's talk about separation of church and state. First, I said there is no church, but I think what you mean is religion in general and the state. And I would argue some other time that the basic notion of separation of church and state had its roots in Muslim countries. This is very surprising to Muslims. Nobody ever thinks so. I always see puzzling expressions on people's faces, but it is true. If somebody wants to know more about it, ask me another question. So what is happening with respect to the situation of women? Basically, there's patriarchy everywhere, including in this society. Nobody is free from it, okay? But what we're seeing in the Muslim world is a compounding of patriarchal influence with authoritarian regimes. And that is why I argue that there is no way to liberate the Muslim woman without at the same time ensuring the presence of a democratic system along Islamic lines. The two fights are one and the same. They're related to each other. You don't go and say, oh, by the way, I'm going to go free Muslim women and leave the rest the way they are. The whole idea is that the society must be based on consent. Forcing, violence, authority is not Islamic. Consent, shura, balance is Islamic. And that's what we're missing. But we're missing it in other societies as well. Only it was compounded by the history of various Muslim countries.
Wait back there, please. Yes.
A lot of the criticisms that we hear about Islam is that, for example, Islam is a sexist religion because when martyrs go to heaven, they find 70 virgins. How do Muslims defend against that?
Well,
first of all,
let me find out in the Quran 70 virgins, and then I'll answer you.
So it's not in the Quran?
No. There is something in the Quran about people who die basically in the cause of justice. Okay, and I think to that extent we're not different from, for example, Christianity, which has the notion of a just war and so on. People who die in the cause of justice, which very often is defensive, not offensive, will have rewards in the afterlife. Okay, and part of these rewards, there is a discussion, not of 90 versions, but of Hur Ayn, and question is, how do you translate that term or even understand it in Arabic? And is it gender specified or not?
Mm-hmm.
Good.
Very true.
That's a whole other question.
Yep. Yeah. What do? You had mentioned that in Kuwait, women are not allowed to vote. And I believe I remember reading in the past year in Qatar, and if it's pronounced gutter, but I may be mispronouncing, they've recently been given the right to vote. Are there more Islamic countries that can vote, that cannot? And could you name some of the
Main? I think Kuwait remains the one place where women cannot vote. If anybody knows otherwise, well, of course, in Saudi, nobody can vote.
Qatar,
they have municipal voting and so on. But Kuwait, the women have. Here's the situation. Let me shed some light on this. Okay. Also, you remember, like in Saudi Arabia, women can't drive. There was an issue about women driving. Both these cases indicate something different. Indicate that if you're bringing about change, if you bring it the wrong way, you lose. Because there was never a question in Saudi, for example, whether women could drive or not. Women were driving outside Riyadh. But then when the American forces in the Gulf War appeared in Saudi Arabia and everything got hot and people were all excited, the women decided that's the right moment, they want to ask for more rights, and then everybody went against them. I mean, where in the Quran does it say the woman cannot drive? Or the man can? I mean, cars are not mentioned. But that has not stopped jurists from reasoning by analogy. So if I use you reasoning by analogy, women drove camels all these years, why can't they drive a car? So what I'm saying is that the problem in Kuwait and the problem in Saudi are really political issues that have been approached in the wrong way, so that they look like as if they were a confrontation and a challenge to the society or to the men in the society, and they reacted against it. And now it becomes a lot more difficult to get what should have been a very easy thing for them to get.
Yeah, Western nations have accused many of third world countries of being oppressive. The Western nations have accused many third world countries of being oppressive to women. Yet the situation often shows otherwise. For instance, Israel elected a Jewish woman, Indira Gandhi, as prime minister. And the largest democracy, India, elected a Hindu woman as prime minister of India. Yet not one, two, three, four, but five Muslim nations have elected women as prime minister. Chile of Turkey, Benazir Bhutto of Pakistan, Hasina and Khalida of Bangladesh, and Megawati Sukarno of Indonesia. So when will America be electing a woman as president?
If you'll vote for me, I'll run.
If you're Muslim and you live by Islamic laws, is there any place in the United States where they're working on getting American laws or American judges to honor that contract.
All right. Now you're asking about the heart of the topic of my book. Family law is a state law, so it differs state by state. I'm working mostly with Virginia law, but I'm familiar with some of the other states. And by the way, since you asked this question, let me mention about a case in California where there was a question whether a marriage, it was a muta marriage, so, it was a muta marriage. So the judge did not know whether there was a real marriage or not, because the concept was very difficult for him. But then he decided on whether it is a real marriage or not by looking at the fact that the husband and wife had separate bank accounts. And he said, that shows they're not really married.
Ah.
You see? So, really, there is a need for education. In another case, which got me started on my book, and by the way, as a result of that, I spent my Fulbright in the Sharia school in Qatar, which you were asking about, talking to the people there. The Virginia county judge decided that he is going to reject the kitab, or the marriage contract of the Muslim couple. Well, why? First of all, let me point out, there's a case called Aziz versus Aziz, which is a New York case, established that the judge in the U.S., well, not for all judges, but they borrow from New York, that a judge could deal with a Muslim marriage contract even though it's Muslim and the state, you know, separates religion from other matters, that he could do that to the extent that the contract is secular. So he deals only with the secular terms of the contract, leaving the religious terms. Okay, so the issue of mahar has been the most prominent provision that the courts have dealt with, and that is the marriage gift translated in English as dowry. Now, one judge, you know, wanted to know what mahar is. They usually bring expert witnesses. The problem we're facing in the American Muslim community is that, which is not very different from other communities, is the husband has usually more money than the wife, and more time and less children. He usually leaves them to her, right? So what happens is that he gets a really good lawyer, and she cannot afford one. You go to the center, sometimes the Islamic center, or to the community, to try and have them donate some money to help the woman get a lawyer. They will not, because the husband has standing in the community and they do not want to offend him, so she's left alone. This is something that my organization, Karama, works on, to try to equalize the powers. The husband goes and gets a witness who gives a testimony about Islamic law, which is either partial or somewhat inaccurate, not because he is corrupt, but because he doesn't know better. There are many imams around here who do not know enough about Islamic law.
Yes.
So, and in one case they brought a professor who is supposed to be a professor of Islam. A professor of Islam, i.e. in religion, does not mean he knows the law. So I don't know what he said. I've been promised that I will finally get a copy of his secret testimony, because there is no, in Virginia, there is no way to force making the testimony public unless the parties agree. Whatever he said, I have no idea what he said, but the judge then decided that he will not honor the Muslim marriage contract because it is contrary to the public policy of the Commonwealth of Virginia. Mm-hmm. It contravenes public policy. A very serious result for Muslims in Virginia who cannot enforce their marriage contracts. It's not the fault of the judge. It's what the husband did with his witness, and the witness who presented himself as an expert. And that's why I decided to write the book. The problem, and I will tell you very honestly, the book is almost ready, but since 9/11, I have not finished it. There's this much left in it, but so much in this country has changed since 9/11 that the priorities have changed. But you're right, something needs to be done. I need to finish this book, and it should be out on the market for judges, lawyers, and others to use it as an app.
Could you hurry it up a little?
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Yeah. Dr. Al-Hibri, you draw a lot from medieval writers, and you state a very clear case for women's rights, the foundation in Islam. But you also seem to be suggesting that over the centuries, we as Muslims have either forgotten or not been true to our Islamic roots, as evidence of inequality in many Muslim countries. So my question to you is, centuries of sincere male believers, how is it plausible that this would be missed or forgotten?
All right. Well, first of all, I don't want to say that there are centuries of believers who did not do it right vis-a-vis women. Because actually, the more you go throughout history, the more modern you get, the worse the woman's situation gets. Okay? If you go even 200 years ago, it was much better. 300, it was much better. Okay? What we're looking at here is really the bottom of what's happening to Muslim women. But how about the various principles I talked about concerning issues of democracy, consent, shura, etc.? I argue, and I can give you the site, it's on the internet, that some very important things happened in the history of Islam very early on, after the death of the Prophet, where some people decided to resort to the rule of to the use of force and abandon the rule of law that was revealed in the Quran. And ever since, the use of force has been adopted as a method for governance, we have moved away from the whole Quran. And every Muslim, whether they agree with my discussion on Muslim women's rights or not, will know exactly what I'm talking about and exactly when the use of force was first used in Islamic history and therefore created all the repercussions we see now. The only way we can go back to the shining example of Medina and the Charter of Medina and the example of the Prophet is to go back to the rule of law as explained in the Quran.
Two more questions, then we adjourn for the reception. Three more questions.
Four to five. I was wondering, most of the Islamic scholars, or most Muslims, the justification they use for the superiority of men over women is a particular ayat in the Quran. And I was wondering if you could expand upon that.
Well, I'm really glad you asked, because that's really the most important question, right? And by the way, that's part of the what is discussed in my book, and it's also been published, so I'm happy to share with you a more detailed treatment of that. There is a verse in the Quran which seems to lead a lot of men to say we are superior to women. And it says other things, which I will not analyze here, but I'm happy to talk to you about it later. When men tell me that, I ask them what is the verse in Arabic. And in Arabic, I ask specifically for the word superior. Where is it? Show me the word. And the word turns out to be qawwamun. What does qawwamun mean? It's certainly not the most straightforward way of saying superior. Especially since in Arabic you say somebody is qawwam over his plants. In part, he takes care of things, right? And I already told you that the man is supposed to take care of the woman, maintenance and otherwise. But even the take care meaning, I mean, you have to look at the verse. It has a beginning and an end, and we only quote the middle. It has a condition. You know, we drop the conditions. We focus on one word. We give it a very specific meaning, which was not necessarily the meaning at all, especially since I already spoke about in Islam, even the relationship of governor to govern to those governed is not one of superiority, and yet in Arabic we call him qawwam. So how come the governor is qawwam over the people? He tends their business, right? But even the verse about qawwamun, a man is qawwam over the woman only in two cases. And the two cases have to, I mean, two conditions have to happen at the same time. It's a conjunction of two conditions before which the man will become qawwam. And therefore, that verse is a limitation on men who thought they are superior to all women. And the Quran said, wait a minute. You know, you're not superior, you're qawwam, and only in those two specific conditions. One of them is if the woman is dependent on you financially. She's not independent financially. You have to feed her and clothe her and put her in a house. You have to take care of her. I mean, after all, you're already taking care of her, right? And in the matter you're taking care of her,
you know more. فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ بَعْضَهُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ. You see, there is fadl, there is more in the situation that you know about it than she does. For example, you know, she wants to go ahead, she just made a little bit of money and she wants to invest it for the first time ever in something, and he's a businessman. He should be able to be qawwam on her. It's his duty to be qawwam. Where's the superiority concept? I don't see it. But it's in the eye of the beholder.
We're hearing now, you know, they're trying to push democracy on Muslim countries. And, you know, the democracy is created by man. So, and, you know, man can be fair and not fair according to one country or another. Hawal Sharia, you know, is the rule of God.
Revelation.
So, you know, and how could you...
Well, that was the hardest thing for me to do. I traveled over the years with USIA and other organizations, the UN, and on my own, to at least 13 Muslim countries. And each country I went to various cities and spoke to grassroots, you know, the public. In one country, I gave a lecture on democracy. When I finished, they demonstrated with me. You know, when I left, they followed me. They wouldn't go home. The whole group said they wanted to have dinner with me. We were having hundreds of people in the audience. They were thirsty for this kind of discussion. But in each time I spoke, every time I spoke, I had first to go through a task. That I'm not working for the CIA. You know, because you have to understand the politics overseas. People are very sensitive of having something pushed on them. Okay, American democracy, is it really a democracy or are they coming to do something in our country? So they had to make sure that I was honest. And I remember one time in one country where a professor stood in the back after I gave my lecture on democracy in Islam, which is, you know, at that time was a very controversial title. And he stood in the back and he started arguing with me word by word about the argument on democracy. And I went with him all the way through to show him that structurally what I'm saying is in the Quran is indeed there. I was in Kuliyat Sharia. Okay, I was surrounded by mullahs and sheikhs and so on. If I made a mistake, I'd lose all credibility. And I went with him step by step until we show that there is a parallel between the two systems. Mm-hmm. And then he said, well, it might be that Islam, Islamic democracy is structurally analogous to American democracy, but he said American democracy is the poisonous tree. I said, I'm not discussing substance. I'm only discussing structure. I'm not into politics. But I'm very, very aware of the fact that our policies, foreign policies, affect how much change somebody like me could make overseas, or how much I could speak overseas about issues if our foreign policy books is too coercive. Okay? That has been a problem. Mm-hmm. And I remember that in some places, I'd be talking to somebody from the assembly, Congress, and in the middle of the conversation, a mullah walks in. And he sits in the back of the room, like he's not there. Mm-hmm. But I'm noticing, because he is the most important person in the room, and he didn't happen to walk in. They sent for him. And then what he does is that in the middle of the conversation, he breaks into Arabic and starts discussing the Quran. And when I answer in Arabic, and after a while, then, you know, and this is an actual, you know, it happened more than once, then when he smiles, because he finds out I know what I'm talking about, then everything else falls into place. Religion is very important. You cannot play with religion. You cannot use it as a tool to achieve political ends. It either comes from the heart or it's not going to happen.
I'm very compelled to understand fully your concept of Iblisi logic and prophetic logic in terms of the realm of gender relations. And does it mean that when a situation comes where you have doubt, does it mean that you either go with the Iblisi or prophetic? Is it that black and white?
I don't know. I mean, I would, maybe later we can talk about a scenario you can tell me about. I'm not exactly clear what you have in mind, but
Let me say that I'm putting an article which discusses these issues on the internet, and maybe if I can take a minute, Karama has, our organization, Muslim Women Lawyers for Human Rights, has a website. I'd like you to take the address. In about a month, we're launching a whole new website, which would be very exciting, and we'd have all these articles online for you to look at. And the place where I introduced the ABC logic was in Indonesia, and it just got published. The website is www.karamah.org. Now, you can go see it now, but in a month it'll be much more exciting. Karama.org.
I want to thank Professor Azizah Al-Hibri, first of all, for accepting our invitation for coming and for educating us, male and female. The lecture series, and may I invite you to join us at the reception of those in the room.
Thank you.